Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning and good evening, depending on where you are. Thank you so much for joining. We're going to start in a couple of minutes. My name is Shahrazad. I'm from ACBAR, Advocacy Manager at ACBAR, and I'd like to welcome you to our event. On the video, you will see not me, but one of our panel members, Ms. Farzana, Fazli. Because our other camera wasn't working properly. So I will be in the background and will introduce you to my colleague, Lisa Piper, director for ACBAR, who will be opening the meeting in 1 minute. So hope you enjoy the event and we'll start. Just a brief housekeeping point. The event will be translated from. Can you hear me? Yes, the event will be translated from Dari into English. If you could kindly switch to, if you need the interpretation, to the channel on Portuguese, because we don't have an option for Dari, so we've opted for Portuguese. Portuguese will take you to a Dari translation. And likewise, the dialogue will be translated from English Dari and Dari into English. So with that, I would like to turn the mic over to Lisa Piper, our director at ACBAR, to open the meeting. Over to you, Lisa.
Thank you so much, Shahrazad. I hope everyone can hear me all right. I am impersonating Yap, who is the vice chair of the ACBAR steering committee. I was having some technical issues with my computer. So I would like to welcome everyone, our panelists, as well as the participants in today's panel. It's a very exciting topic, a very timely topic, and I'm really looking forward to listening and participating in the discussion as we look at how women can be meaningful, contributing economic agents in Afghanistan. So thank you very much to everyone for your time and your ideas and your discussion. And I wish you all a wonderful panel. Thank you very much. Shahrazad, I will turn the floor back over to you, please.
Thank you very much, Lisa. And without further ado, I will hand over to our event moderator, Ms. Manizha Wafeq. Thank you.
Thank
can
you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you. Thank you, Shahrazad John. And
yes, so over to you, Manizha John, and I'll give you the opportunity to introduce yourself.
Yes, thank you. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Of course, outside Afghanistan, and good evening, everyone in Afghanistan. This is really great for ACBAR to organize this event and having us join them today. Afghanistan Women's Chamber of Commerce. I'm Manizha Wafeq, the president and co-founder. It's really great to talk about some great ideas today. You can see the title of the event, Thinking Out of the Box. I'm really happy that we have a really great entrepreneurs who have started businesses that are really thinking out of the box. And as AWCCI, we have this slogan that we say, Afghan women are not economic beneficiaries, but they are economic actors. So today we will see through this great panel, and as well as through the presentation of some data, that really Afghan women are economic actors. And if we have a great recognition and a great appreciation for their role as economic actors, all of us together can really be of better support to expand the horizon for women's participation in economic activities in Afghanistan. So I would like to jump into the panel discussion. We have four panelists, Sara, Wahedi, Marghuba, Safi, Peshraft, Forough, and Farzana, Fazli. I am not going to introduce them as much as I want to, because they all have done a great job and have started these great enterprises, because I would like them to speak about what they have done. So let's hear from each one of them on how did they come up with this ideas, with these ideas, and how they were able to start these great enterprises. And I would like to ask them, first of all, to tell us what is the enterprise, and then tell us how did they come up with the idea and how did they start. So I would like to start with Sarajan Wahedi. Sarajan, let's see, what's the enterprise that you're running and how did you come up with this idea?
Thank you so much, Manizha John, and thank you so much to the rest of the panel. It is a pleasure to be amongst you all. Yes, my name is Sara Wahedi, and I am the CEO and founder of Ehtesab, which is one of Afghanistan's first civic technology startups. And our main purpose is really to bridge the gap between citizens and government officials and city officials, and really bridge that communication gap with community members and citizens. The way that we came up with Ehtesab was actually because I was stuck in a explosion in Police District 10, which is in Sharnal, Chori, Aj Yaqub. And it was a really horrific attack. And the next morning we had no electricity, the streets were closed. And I was wondering how I could get into contact with city officials regarding electricity and just some of the road blockages that were happening due to the explosion. And no one in my area knew who was the city representative, how we could get into contact with city services. There was no real direct way of any sort of accountability or access to city officials who are public servants. And slowly we decided to come up with a platform that citizens can send in reports based on issues such as sanitation, city services, corruption, security, and would be able to directly send those to Ehtesab, which eventually we would send to city officials to get a response and to rate their response. And the purpose of this is to kind of create that transparency and that accountability within the city to show the severity and frequency of these types of issues. Because we really use Facebook, we use Twitter, we use a lot of social media platforms, but we really don't collate this really important information. We don't save it, we don't record it. And Hisab wants to make that situation transparent and to ensure that citizens are a part of the policymaking process. So right now we're in data collection phase, and eventually we would love to work with the government to send those reports and to get them into that accountability aspect and that kind of collaboration with citizens. So currently in phase one, and eventually we would love to work with the government on phase two.
Great. So necessity is mother of invention. And in this case, this was unfortunate that you had to go through what you had to, but at last something great came out of it. Thank you. So did you get any support for starting this, Sarajan?
Yes. So initially it was very, very difficult, Manizha John, because it's a civic technology platform. Probably as Fereshteh John knows, technology in Afghanistan is something that people are very hesitant to invest in. Thankfully, we got a technical investor in Netlinks, and they've been very supportive in providing us with technical assistance regarding the management and the development of the application and the platform. They've been very, very supportive, but we do understand that civic technology requires government support. And right now, we're trying to figure out how we can involve the government and the city without them encroaching on citizens' reports. We don't want people to be hiding reports. We don't want people to be deleting reports. And we're still trying to figure out how we can involve the government without any sort of very deep involvement in trying to maybe quiet certain types of reports, because it is a very controversial kind of thing, because we have gotten reports about corruption, we have gotten reports about harassment, and we want to be very careful about how we are managing those reports. So in the private sector, there has been a lot of interest. At the public sector, we're still trying to figure out how to manage the platform in a collaborative and transparent way.
Great. Okay, I'm glad that you had some support, and best of luck with getting support from the government. And yeah, let's see how it goes. So I'll come back to you, Sarajan. Let's go to Marghubajan Safi. Marghubajan, I know you're doing a great job with your organic soap. So let's hear from you about this enterprise. How did you come up with this idea, and how did you start, and how is it going now?
Thank you, Manizha John, and hello everyone, and good evening. This is Marghuba Safi, founder and CEO of Peshraft Zanan from Kabul, Afghanistan. As you know, for several years, I taught women how to start their own businesses. To accomplish this, I have worked with several NGOs in the past 20 years. However, the women always had complaint about lack of money or external support to their businesses. Therefore, I started my own business to encourage and show them that it is possible to start a business without lots of money. So I started my company, Peshraft Zanan, in 2016 from my apartment's kitchen. That was very interesting. Throughout 2016 and to 2019, I was able to expand my business from my apartment's kitchen to a small factory and two farms. That now we have two farms, organic farms, and also a small factory that there a lot of women are working. Now there we have 20 official women employees in our company. That this is the story of my business.
Great, Marghubajan. So where are you getting, or where did you find the recipe of these soaps that you have started producing?
I received a training from a foreigner woman that she was my best friend, and I learned from her.
Great. So you learned it from her, but of course you wanted to start this, and you did a great job starting this business.
Thank you.
Did you receive any other support when you started this business?
For starting my business, I didn't receive any support, but for training other women, I received support from UNODC that they support me to train rehab addicted women, that I transfer my skill to 200 rehab addicted women, that it was I was very happy about that I transferred my knowledge, my skill to other women to start their own businesses.
Thank you. Thank you for doing this. That's great. And I can see there is a lot of hope for expanding it, and as well as there's a lot of horizon for expanding it to other provinces, especially if you have worked with the addicted women. Let's see if our audience also, they have questions, they can keep their questions for later. We'll come to them. So our panelists could answer their questions. But now I will move to our next panelist, Fereshteh Farzana. Fereshteh, let's hear from you. You have also started a tech-related business. So what is it and how's it going and how did you come up with this idea?
Sure, well, good morning, everyone, and good evening, everyone from different parts of the world. Thanks for having me. First of all, about the enterprise, I'm the founder and executive director of Code to Inspire, the first computer coding school for girls in Afghanistan. Founded the school in November 2015, and we have only one location right now. It's in Herat, Afghanistan. So certainly for me, I think creating Code to Inspire was very personal because of my life story, being born as a refugee in Iran. And like a lot of refugees, just being denied accessing education was very important for me, and it was a big challenge. And I was fortunate enough that I could finish my high school in Iran. And then when I came back to Afghanistan and I studied computer science in Herat University, and also being a professor in the university for 3 years, I've noticed that there's a lot of challenges for women, particularly in the tech area. And the lack of workforce and employment opportunities for them was a big issue. So that was the reason for me to kind of like think that how I can create something that really can change the momentum, not only for the women in education, but also for women in technology. And that was the reason that I founded Code to Inspire. And really the pillar of the work is that first, we want to create a safe and secure educational environment for young ladies who can come, and the family can trust our space and they can feel comfortable. And then the second, we offer the school for free. We don't charge students because a lot of the girls come from a challenging financial backgrounds. And the third, which is the most important pillar of the work, is what kind of technical skills we teach these young ladies so it can be translated either into entrepreneurship or employment opportunities within the community, or we can outsource projects to them and they can get money remotely. So with that being said, we do offer classes right now. It's an after-school program, and our main target group are college girls students as of now. And we offer classes in mobile application, game design, graphic design, web development, cryptocurrency, and blockchain. And as of now, we've educated more than 200 students in our coding school. And we've done about 20 remote outsourcing projects worth of $20,000, where all the money went to the girls' pocket. And actually about like 10% or 20% of our graduates became entrepreneurs and create their own startups. And 60% of our graduates found job within the local community. So that's kind of like in a nutshell about what we are doing right now.
That's great, Fereshteh. So the ones that has started their startups, how are they doing right now? Are they getting any support from your side on a continuous basis, or have you connected them with other opportunities, including organizations that are supporting them?
Yeah, so we really try to keep track of the data and our graduates with the alumni and the ones who became entrepreneur. We help them with materials if they need, for example, if they want to write business plans, presentation, pitch decks, and, you know, with their financials, but also trying to reach out to our own internal network in a way that if we can also like help them with any remote outsource project. And also like they also did a great job themselves in case of really going out and presenting themselves. Actually, one of the entrepreneurs, they actually raised some funds from some UN related organizations, and with that fund they could get a space and also like hire women. So we really try to cultivate the relationship that we can with the local community, but also be a voice for them outside of Afghanistan and see how we can really help them to get more momentum and also more audience outside of Afghanistan as well.
Okay, that's great. And inside Afghanistan too, we need a lot of audience there to become their clients, because I think today all the colleagues and friends from all different organizations that have joined us today. They all can think of buying from Afghan businesswomen and really contracting them. And when we say buy from Afghan women, we don't only mean the products, the tangible products, but we also mean these services. We have the government of Afghanistan that has included a 5% preferential clause in the government's national procurement procedure. And currently we are doing well with the National Procurement Authority, getting some contracts for businesswomen there, but we are hoping that our international partners as well consider a percentage as a preferential scoring or setting aside some contracts on an annual basis for Afghan businesswomen. So this way, you're not only supporting in terms of really setting up their businesses or running, helping them to run their businesses successfully, but you're really buying from them, and they are feeling more of a being a partner and equal to you than just being a beneficiary of the projects and programs, for which, of course, we are very grateful. And things that has happened in Afghanistan has not been anywhere in the world. So thank you for that. But let's also now think about becoming clients of our businesswomen. Clients of businesses that you all have supported to be created in Afghanistan. So let's go to our next panelist, Farzana John. Farzana John Fazli in jewelry. So let's see how and where did she get the training and how did she start this business of designing jewelry, and how is she doing today? Farzana John. Farzana John, would you be able to help Farzana John to unmute herself and speak?
Yes, I'm passing the mic on to Farzana John.
Okay, great. Thank you.
سلام با شما، سلام با کس به همه کسایی که تصویر ما رو میبینن. فرزانه فضلی هستم، رئیس کمپانی دایموند سلطان رازیا. کمپانی دایموند سلطان رازیا ما در سال 2005 کارش رو کردیم. البته برنامه ما یک برنامه آموزشی از طرف سفارت ایتالیا، ایتالیان کوپریشن بود که در باغ زنانه ایجاد شده بود. از اون جمله کسا علاقه من ما خودم بودم که در اون برنامه اشتراک کردم. اون آموزش به مدت 6 ماه در بخش جیمز کتنگ ما ترینینگ دیدیم. بعد از مدت 6 ماه یک برنامه بود که از طرف خود بازم سفارت ایتالیا ما رکومت کردن، به این روان کردن به خاطر خریداری بعض وسایل ماشینری تا که بتانیم در پولیزی که جیمز کتنگ کار میکنیم بتانیم کار زرگجی هم پیش ببریم، یک کار مکمل باشه که بتانیم زیورات سازی رو به شکل مکمل یاد بگیریم. مدت یک سال دیگه هم ما ترینینگ در بخش زیورات دیدیم. بعد از مدت یک سال برنامه های ایتالیان کوپریشن ختم شد. تقریبا در برنامه ایتالیان کوپریشن 24 خانم بود، دختر خانم ها بودن که از او جمله یک شما بودن. از... بله. بعد از مدت ترنینگ من خودم خواستم که چیزی را کاموزش دیده بودم، خواستم خود دفاع باشم و کار کنم پیش برم. بعدش هم تلاش کردم، زحمت کشیدم، پیش رفتم و تا حال کار کردم ایران. در سال 2009 خودم باز یک برنامه را ایجاد کردم که در باغ زنانه کابل، البته حمایت از طرف سفارت ایتالیا میشد، حمایت مالی شما. من خودم به منحیث ترنر اونجا دختر خانم های دیگر را ترنینگ دادم، تقریبا 12 دختر بود، مدت 9 ماه اونا را ترنینگ دادیم. بعدش هم فعلا بزنس خودم است پیش میبرم.
بسیار خوب.
متفاوت است، متفاوت البته از مارکت افغانستان است، تمامش کار دست است، سنگ قیمتی و نیمه قیمتی افغانستان با شکل زیورا جور کنیم و تولیدات رو میکنم. علاقه منده بسیار زیاد دارم، مارکت‌های خوبم دارم به خاطر فروش می‌کنم.
کی است مشتریتون فعلا فرزانه جان؟ با کیا مفروشین و در کجا مفروشین؟
مشتری ما اکثرا زیادترش خارجی هستند، از خوردخانه و گست هاوس و جایا و کسایی که کار میکنن مشتری ما بودن، اونا زیادتر کسایی که رفتن اومدی جا فعلا اوردر میکنن و واشون جور میکنن.
بسیار
دیزاین میکنن و اکثرا دیزاین میخوان و افغانم هستن زیادتر افغانای خودمون برای دیزاینی که ما میکنم زیادتر لحظه بود.
بسیار خوب. کدام مغازه دارین یا تنها کارخانه تولیدی دارین و از طریق آنلاین اونا چی رو میگیرین، فرمایش ها رو میگیرین و تهیه میکنین و باز برشون روان میکنین؟
ما کارخانه داریم. کارخانه ما کوچه مرغا مارکت صنایع دستی کابل است و در کارخانه داریم. در موجه ما یک شروع داریم. نویا را که میکنیم تصویش روان میکنیم با مشتریم و اونا انتخاب کرده بعدشان تصمیم میگیریم.
چند نفر کارمند دارین فعلا؟
فعلا شش خانم است و سه نفر هم از مردا هستن
که کار میکنن. بسیار خوب. کلان کار کردین فرزانه جان. نام خدا 6-9 نفر و شمول خودتان 10 نفر شما فعلا مصروف ساختین و همه گیا مطمئن استم که خانواده خود از لحاظ اقتصادی میتونن از طریق امی آیده که از طریق شما به دست میارن حمایت بکنن. دیگه کار بسیار فوق العاده است. ما میره میخواییم که خدا خانواده ما مثل شما وره هم یک فعالیت اقتصادی رو شروع کنن که هم خود مصروف بسازن و هم دیگرها را مصروف بسازن و منتظر از این نباشن که یک کس اونا را استخدام کنه. دیگه شما یکی از متشبثین بسیار مبتکر و زحمتکش و فوق العاده ماستین و افتخار میکنیم. تشکر. خوب است، ما پس باز میایم به سوالای بعدی فرزانه جان. حالا میریم سوالای دیگه که دارم از سارا جان و دیگه دوستا سوال میکنیم. Alright, so I'll come back to our first panelist with my next question. Sarajan, so how do you see the social impact of this enterprise that you have started, and how do you see the opportunity for our international partners, our government entities in Afghanistan to kind of replicate, or maybe if not replicate, but how to expand this kind of business for other women, and how to really make use of this for improving women's lives, so to say.
Definitely. I mean, in regards to women, I think that one of the ideas that we had for Ehtesab and its potential is a lot of things where women cannot report concerns that they have, whether it's harassment, whether it's just limitations that they have. Being an Afghan woman is one of the reasons why we created Ehtesab as an Afghan woman. It's why I felt it was important for us to have a platform such as this where people can send in reports, send in their concerns. So there is that context in which we have a platform where people can send in their concerns and feel that it's not going to get lost, that it's not just going to go through Facebook feeds or Twitter feeds, and it's going to go somewhere that's going to be recorded and it's going to be sent to the proper entities. And that's really our last hope with Ehtesab, is that we get to a point where we can provide these types of concerns that women have to the proper entities, and that it is responded to accordingly. And regarding, you know, the involvement of other agencies, I think that right now the value in civic technology is something that still requires a lot of support from government and whether it's international agencies. It's something that has a lot of potential to grow in the private sector aspect. Creating platforms like this in other provinces and other cities where we have platforms that municipalities can use, that provinces can use to connect with their citizenry, there is that potential. And as Ehtesab, as that we create these types of platforms, that is something that we are able to build and design for whatever province or city requires it, or municipality or ministry. And we would like to build these types of tools that connect citizens, clients, to the individuals that they need to connect with. So there is that aspect as well. I think there is a lot of potential regarding increasing support, and that is something that we would like to see further on. And obviously with Ehtesab, we are working as best as we can to connect to the proper entities to see that happen. And also I would like to involve more women in the process. Right now it is quite difficult to find women who are a little bit more willing to be outgoing and to speak publicly, but we would like to eventually, have more women involved and be involved in women's circles to really maximize the potential of Ehtesab when it comes to women and the policies that we can push forward. But there is a lot of potential. We're still in the first phases, but I'm mm-hmm. very hopeful about its capacity.
Yes, it looks very hopeful. Just one question that just came into my mind. So where is the revenue source with this application or the platform that you're creating?
Right. So for the current Ehtesab that you see and you can download, that's for Kabul. It's kind of like a present that we created for the city that we call home. Mm-hmm. We don't have any revenue stream from the Kabul app, but eventually mm-hmm. we would like to do is we would like to be able to offer our services to build tools like Ehtesab for other municipalities, services, okay. support systems to connect citizens to their city officials and to their ministries. We will be able to create these types of tools for ministries and cities as well.
Okay, great. So yeah, I know some projects that are supporting IDLG and municipalities and good governance, so maybe they can be your clients to work with you and buy this app for the municipalities or provinces that they are working at. So I hope that they're there, they're here today, and they hear us and they become your clients, Sarajan. Okay, so anything else that you would like to share, Sarajan, on this point of how international partners, government, and everyone could really expand on these efforts that you're doing?
I think that, Ehtesab essentially is like a Safai Shar, but something that records very important data for Afghans. And what I'd really like to emphasize to international agencies and organizations who are looking for things to fund is that change doesn't need to be the typical kinds of projects that we see in Afghanistan. It doesn't need to be just helping people who are, on their knees and are, that we are these kind of unabled people. There's a lot of interesting projects that are very innovative, that are very forward thinking, that just require some funding. And it's a tool that, collates and records important information, and agencies are all about data and evidence and reports. And what Ehtesab wants to do is we want to record these really important reports from Afghans all across the country, right now in Kabul, obviously. And we'd like to show in what neighborhoods are, projects going really well. For example, if UN Habitat is building, a sanitation area or dams or whatever it is, and it's going really well in a certain neighborhood, we want to show the progress of that. We want to show that people are really interested and supportive. And if there's a nahiya or an area of Kabul that is getting no support, but the municipality of Kabul is spending millions of dollars on a park or something that doesn't need to be supported, we have types of really important reports from people saying, we just want steps from a mountain to come down during the winter time. We want some support from the municipality. And if we're able to connect the bridge between citizens and city officials and record this, then I think that we have a really great platform that we can work on. So it would be just really my message to support innovative businesses and startups that think outside of the box, as our theme is today, but really to believe in us and to give us that opportunity.
Great. And this was one of the questions from our audience as well, that is there any partnership between Kabul University and civic technology, and what is required to help these small scale projects to mid-level businesses? So if you have a very specific recommendation on how, we heard you that they should support or we need them to support the innovative ideas. But how, Sarajan, if you just have very shortened, answer to this.
So very, very directly, no, there is no connection right now with Kabul Municipality and Ehtesab. The reason behind that is because Kabul Municipality already had an application which had a budget of $14 million, which we don't. We have a $0 budget. So we're trying to see where we can collaborate. We haven't really spoken out to them. We've tried, but they haven't responded to us. And what's required to make these types of projects successful, we just really need that initial funding. That initial funding allows us to have that initial step, and we don't have that. So we need people to look into us and to give us that opportunity.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Sarajan. All right, so I'll go to Fereshteh-jan. Fereshteh-jan, the same question. I would ask you as well, what are the possibilities or scope for our partners to build on these efforts and help and support more women and expand these efforts outside these major cities like Herat or Kabul? Sarajan's working, and many of us are usually based in these bigger cities. So how can we do that, Fereshteh-jan?
Well, I mean, definitely, I think there is a huge potential for the work that we are doing, because what we see that, like, at least on a weekly basis, we receive a lot of message from the girls around Afghanistan, either through our social media or the email, that they're asking us if we are able to open the school in the region. For example, recently we had like a new classes for 2021, and we had about 200 applicants who wants to join the school. And with the limited resources we have in case of the physical location and taking the security of the school and everything, we are just like able to accept like 100 or like 80 students per year to have in our school. So certainly there's a huge potential in case of growth and a scale. And we see that since that we started the school, which there were very few awareness about technology and women being in technology. But right now we see that a lot of women are interested, which is a very positive outcome of maybe some of the work that we're doing in Afghanistan as well with promoting, you know, the technology education for women. So we would love to expand and grow the school as much as we can. The issue here is that we are a nonprofit organization and we are purely rely on funding. However, for us, we're really now thinking with what happened, especially with COVID and a lot of the changes that happened within the industry, we are also thinking to be more sustainable in a way that we can create our own business model to generate revenue so that it can help us to put the money in case of growing and scaling. And we are doing it, as I mentioned earlier, that we are doing outsourcing projects, but it's that we don't monetize it for the organizations. All the money goes to the girls' pocket as of now. But really, like, because we work with technology, a lot of the things are related to infrastructure. So we need to have a supportive, good infrastructure in whatever we are going. So electricity is very important. And as you all know, that when it's very cold in winter and hot summer, we do face with electricity shortage and we have to use generator. We need high speed internet, and it's not accessible in all of the places. So it makes us to really think about and narrow down the areas that we are able to do. And of course, Kabul, Mazar, and a lot of other places that do have the potential, it's on the list for us. To definitely scale and growth, I think one is the government support here in case of, like, if they can help us either, you know, with donating space or, you know, providing some sort of kind of like partnership in a way that when our graduates finish their classes, we can create some sort of like pool of employment opportunities that the government can support and place those graduates there so that it can help them as well with the representation of women, you know, within the governmental organizations, that still there is a lack in case of technology. And also, like, to your questions about, I think you mentioned about the social impact of the work that we do and really like the areas that we try to work on, that it's also like very important for us to not only educate women, but also to change the perspective of the community towards women in technology. So we've created a lot of different apps and games that are geared towards certain problem within the community, and we wanted to raise awareness. And one of the recent apps that we actually created was Afghan Hero Girl game. And it was very eye-opening because we wanted to create a game that the superhero is a girl, because in a lot of the game, there's a man who is a superhero. And also there's a lack of representation. There's not like even women from different regions of the world who being, you know, the superhero. So we created that girl wearing the traditional outfit of Afghanistan and running through different stages. And that's actually really like represent the daily lives of the women in Afghanistan who face challenges. We really received a lot of great feedbacks. There was like thousands of downloads and hundreds of comments, which we were very surprised. And there were a lot of men who were, you know, very engaged and involved with that. So which was amazing to see that. So what that's also like what we try to do to, you know, create our own superheroes and encourage more women to join the STEM and be a voice that can change the future of the technology space within Afghanistan.
Thank you. Thank you, Fereshteh. You're doing a great job, I think. And one specific question. So if we if you get support to have a proper infrastructure, security, and everything that you need in Herat, would you be able to, first of all, would you be able to train girls from the neighboring provinces of Herat, of the West region? And if so, would this be helpful for them? Would this be helpful for them in their provinces? Like what would be the use of the kind of work that you're doing in Ghor, Badghis, Nimroz, or Farah? So if you can be brief, then please.
Yeah, I mean, like, look, what we're doing is really like creating a safe space is very important for us. But on the other hand, we're working with technology, which means that if you have an internet and like a laptop, you don't necessarily need a physical location. You can do you can do a lot of work online without like the geographical boundaries. So yes, as much as we would love to have a physical location to grow and have more girls come, but we think that like, especially with the current situation in Afghanistan, you know, the security aspects, the limitation of family, allowing the girls to travel by themselves. And even with the COVID again, and what's has changed the future for tech ed and also the workforce. What we are very interested to see is that how we can kind of like create more like a hybrid model in a way that we can provide a small kind of like secure space for them, but also like having an online platform where we can reach out more girls within Afghanistan and they can go through the same program with support. So that's what we are thinking to see and explore in the future, especially given the facts that I said about the challenges.
Great. So one question from the audience. Do girls need English for doing coding?
Well, I mean, like definitely English is very important, but we do have like students who came to the school with zero knowledge of English and we help them. So we provide like supplemental and like classes for them. But when you start coding, like more or less, if you even don't know English, you kind of like forced to learn it, which is a good thing for them. But yes, we help them also with English materials.
Okay, great. Thank you, Fereshteh. I'd like to go to Marghuba John Safi. And among the audience, we have Ambassador Rose Wilson from the U.S. Embassy. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us today. And a number of your questions, I'm sure, were answered in terms of what are holding their businesses from progressing. But I'll ask some questions like practically how they do they access or build market for themselves. With Marghuba John Safi. Marghuba John, the same question. How do you see the scope for expanding these efforts for other women, and how are you accessing markets?
Thank you, Manizha John. First, I want to say that it's part of our future plan to expand our business in other provinces of Afghanistan to create jobs for more women. Although with external support, we can accomplish our goal in shorter time period. But if we go by our own, it will take time. But if we got support from other companies or Afghan institution or government or international community, it will go very fast to other provinces and we will create more jobs for women. Mm-hmm. Also, the goal and also the benefit of extending our business to other provinces will we will able to create more job opportunities and for women, and also we can decrease the domestic violence with creating more job, and mm-hmm. also when women work, then they will have an income. When they have income, then their economic situation would be improved. And mm-hmm. also they would have higher self-esteem or confidence in their personal life. Also, the economical situation of our country could improve. Besides, there is a saying that women and men are two wings of a bird. If one wing does not work, then the bird would not be able to fly. Mm-hmm. And however, if both wings work together, then the bird could reach its goal. Yeah. By this, if we extend the business to other provinces, we will help our economy, have our women create more jobs for women, help improve self-esteem among the women, and also we will help to reduce the war also if we create more jobs. And we will have an outstanding role in bringing peace in our country by increase our businesses.
Great, Marghuba-jan. So how about accessing markets? How are you doing that, Marghuba-jan?
For accessing in market, we have some sales point in the city, in mm-hmm. Shahre now, in high mm-hmm. level VIP stores like Finest, Spanish, and other middle level markets and stores, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. also. But till now, we don't have a permanent market for us in the city. This is our strong need to have our own sales point in showroom in the city that still we don't have because it needs. More budget and also for decor them and for other support we need more budget that for this situation we are not able to do but we distribute our products to other markets and they sell for okay. us and they receive some money from that. But if we have our own showroom, then we will receive the money directly from our customer that now we are not in this stage.
Yeah, that's, I was thinking that maybe you don't need your own or maybe a specific showroom for yourself, but in order to decrease in order to remove the middleman and to get the whole revenue for yourself and for the women who are working so hard to produce these soaps, then definitely we there is a need for your own shop, Marghuba-jan.
Yeah, there is a strong need.
I hope that we'll be able to do that. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Marghuba-jan. Anything else would you like to recommend or tell us today?
Thank you. Just today, I received good news about land for women that for their businesses in Barikop. That it was a good news for me that I mm-hmm. applied for that. Inshallah, in the near future, we will have our own land for our factory, and there as I heard from AWCCI also, but today mm-hmm. I applied for this land that hopefully in future 1 month or maybe 2 months, I have my own factory and I will create more job for more women of our country.
Great. Congratulations, Marghuba Jan.
Thank you.
So as Marghuba Jan talked about the land and industrial park, I would like to share with the audience that we worked with the government to get some allocations of the industrial parks for women. And so we had success. There was an inclusion of a clause, 15 to 25% of the industrial parks to be allocated to women and SMEs. And for that, we have a specific procedure now with the Ministry of Industry and Commerce. And we have, of course, lower criteria for women and SMEs to access those lands in the industrial parks whenever they need them. So we see now practical examples, and that's great. Thank you, Marghuba Jan, and best of luck with building your factory.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah, inshallah, near future, news. Inshallah, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Okay. خب دوستا ما میرم طرف فرزانه جان. فرزانه جان از یکی از شما شنیدیم بسیار کار فوق العاده نام خدا دانا فرمصروف هستین در تجارت. چی فرصت وجود داره فرزانه جان که بتانیم این کار وسط بتیم و خانم های بیشتر از این مستفید بسازیم، هم ممکن در اطراف کابل و هم خارج از کابل، البته در سایر ولایات بخاطر ازی که توجه بیشتر ما از به بعد اگه بیشتر سر ولایت باشه خوبتر خود بود که مساویه را ما بتونیم بخانه ما را در کل ولایت انکشاف بتیم، تمام سازی اقتصادیشان انجام بتیم و وضعیت زندگیشان را بهتر بسازیم. فرزانه جان بفرمایید.
تشکر. من جان ما یه موقع دید بخش خانم های زیاد را ترنینگ دادیم و رای ما هستن کار میکنن. بسیار گپ خوب است که در تمام ولایات اگر ولایتی که واقعا امن باشه و امکاناتی یا پایش باشه که برن خانمایی که بتونن آموزش ببینن، ما کسایی را داریم، اونا خانم هستن و امرای خانم ها زیادتر راحت می باشن، می تونیم ترنینگ ویدیا را آن کنیم من حیث ترنر باشن ترنینگ بتن. فرصت بسیار خوب برای چون بخش زرگری و زیورات سازی خانم‌ها در افغانستان بسیار کم بود. در کسایی که شروع کرد، اولین کسم خودم بودم، در بخش آموزش زرگری کار کردم و پیش رفتم و خوشبختانه که ما خانم‌ها شان دختر خانم‌های دیگران بتونن خودشان ترنینگ دیدن، بتونن اونا آموزش بدن کسای دیگران.
بسیار خوب. فرزانه جان، کدام پیشنهاد مشخص دیگه اگه داشته باشین که خب میگین که ترنینگ بتیم، اما چطور و چی منابع نیاز است که این آموزش ها را وسط بتیم؟ و اگر این آموزش ها را وسط بتیم، سوال بسیار عمده ای است که آیا بازار کافی است به این تولیداتی که باز خانمان انجام بتن؟ خب خصوص در این قضیه دوباره زیورات گپ میزنیم، شما آیا بازار کافی است، مشتری کافی وجود می داشته باشد که تعداد زیاد اگه در این بخش آموزش میبینن باز بتانن از این طریق آید داشته باشن؟
جان فعلا شرایط وضعیت هیچ خوب نیست، البته روز به روز هم که من دیدم میرم شرایط افغانستان خراب شده میره. انشالله ما آرزو میکنم که روز باشه که شرایط و همه چیز خوب باشه، تولیداتی که سنگایی که خود افغانستان داره و تولیداتی را که مردم افغانستان انجام میتن، انشالله روز باشه که مارکت های بسیار خوب داشته باشیم برش به خاطر فروشاتش و همه گی امیدواری پیدا کنن به زندگی. یه چیز گفتن نمیتونم، اما آرزو دارم که انشالله همه چیز خوب شوه.
انشالله که همه چیز خوب شوه. صادرات به شکل حجم زیاد انجام دادین فرزانه جان یا نه؟ یا به مقدار کم روان کردین بیرون از افغانستان بر مشتریتان؟
تا 5 کیلو زیورات هم روان کردین.
تا 5 کیلو روان کردین. در اون قسمت چیز مشکلات بوده یا یکی بسیار به سهولت تونستین صادر کنین؟ بس ولا تونستین صادر کنین خب بسیار خوب وقتی که سوالای از دوستا بود که آیا در صادرات کدام امتیاز وجود داره بر خانما یا خیر که متاسفانه کدام امتیاز وجود نداره در صادرات اما بعض اوقات مثل که فرزانه جان کدام مشکل با مشکل روبرو نشدن اما بعض اوقات بعض مشکلات وجود داره و ای به خودم و کالا تعلق داره که کالا چی هسته که ما صادر میکنیم و به می ترتیب باز پروسا و طرز العمل ها مختلف است و میتونه بعض اوقات ممانعت باشه میتونه بعض اوقات هم سهولت باشه در قسمت صادر کردنش یا شما خوشبخت بودین که زیورات مشکلات نداشته و شما تونستین رو صادر کنین بسیار خوب تشکر بسیار زیاد فرزانه جان All right, we are almost done with the questions that I've had for the panelists, and I asked them some of the questions that our audience had asked. If there is anything else, Charles or John, colleagues from Magbar, please share. The floor is open to everyone. Charles or John?
Yes, we hope that everyone has received answers to their questions, but if not, definitely follow up. Some of the questions are quite technical, but very interesting and also food for thought. So if there aren't any questions that have been left unanswered, we can perhaps thank our panel members for their time and for their really amazing insights to their creative thinking. And we
yes, okay, until Shahzad John come back, her voice come back.
Manizha John, will your colleague, yes. Sorry, was there a problem with hearing me?
yes.
Oh, sorry about that.
No, it's okay.
Sorry, yeah, how is it now? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now. Yes, it's better.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that everyone's happy that they've received answers to their very interesting questions. But again, if not, after this event with Manisha John, and we'll make sure that we get answers to your questions. And thank you very much to everyone. But I just wanted to thank the panel members and Manisha John. Thank you so much for moderating it so expertly from afar.
You're
and if you agree, we can move to the next section.
Yes, let's move to the next segment. And my colleague Saida John is in the call. I'm hoping that she's able to turn on her camera. But if not, because anyways, we are sharing a screen because we are presenting our data today to our great audience and colleagues. We have had this database for the last 5 years almost, because we started in 2015 at even before we name ourselves as AWCCI, Afghanistan Women's Chamber of Commerce, as lead, we have had this database of business women in Afghanistan. And we have continuously collected data throughout Afghanistan and have shared those data about women owned businesses in the country. But recently, since May this year, we started a very robust effort to collect data on the formal businesses that were left unrecognized and were not part of this database. And also we added another section to this database that we maintain at AWCCI for informal businesses, because as we were in touch with a lot of our international and national NGOs and partners, and we could see that there were more informal businesses than formal businesses in the country, but we didn't have consolidated information about them. So we put together that effort and we collected data, and we are happy to share this for the first time today through this event. It's important to thank some of the partners who helped us. Harakat was instrumental, two other partners later supported us to complete the data collection and data entry that we are presenting today. Those were, of course, our Her Excellency, the First Lady, and the Ghazanfar Bank. The two of them supported us to complete the data collection entry as Harakat support got finished. So we had to ask some others to help us to complete that. So I would like to ask Saida John to turn on her mic and start sharing the data. And I'm going to start the share my screen for the presentation that she has prepared. All right. So just I would apologize for just a second to share the screen. Okay, here is it. Okay, is everyone seeing it? Shahzad John?
Yes, we're seeing everything, thank you.
Okay, great. Saida John, are you there?
Yes, Saida John.
Okay, great. So please, I will just go through. Please start. I think I did this introduction, so.
Yes, thank you. You have just covered the introduction part.
Yeah, let's go to this one directly to what are the numbers?
Yes, thank you, Manizha John, and good day and good evening to all the participants. It's great to see you all here, and thank you for having me in here. As Manizha John just mentioned, I'm Saida Faqirzadeh, the director of Women Business Resource Center, and proudly working and supporting women businesses through AWCCI. Our presentation is based on the women business activities and based on the information and the data we have in our database. So Manizha John covered all of the introduction of our database from where we have started and from lead organization, and it comes to the AWCCI, which these data helped other government and international organization to reach out to these business women and help and support them through their services. So in this slide, we can see that we have provincial activities of business women. We have included formal and informal data. Let me apologize for our poor quality of our charts. We were working on improving the shape and the style of these charts. So it would take lots of time. So just apologize for this. So we have these business women official in most of the provinces, but at least we have covered 32 provinces, which the businesswomen are active in these provinces, but unfortunately we are not having any active businesswomen in two provinces, but most of them are in Kabul, Herat, Balkh, Kandahar, Ninghar, Bamyan, and it's decreasing, like as you can see in the chart, and in other provinces. So the total number of our informal businesses, as you can see, the figure is more than 2,000, and the total number of informal women businesses is more than 50. You can see in the chart, because we have added the informal businesses as individuals as in groups. So we have entered all of the information about these business women in our database, but the chart is showing the total number of our informal women businesses. The formal businesses, we have most of the informal businesses, women businesses in Kandahar, Helmand, Bamyan, Nimruz, and some of other provinces. They are not most likely in Kabul and Herat and Balkh, but they are all in Kandahar, Helmand, and Bamyan and Nimruz provinces. Yes, Manizha John, next slide.
Yes. Mm-hmm. sectors?
On behalf of women businesses sectors, we have the data of all of the sectors which are women are active in these businesses areas. So these business women, including all formal and informal, are mostly engaged in all of the services. But most of them are engaged in clothing production and services, education, food processing, and other sectors. As you can see again in the chart, that our informal businesses are most likely engaged in clothing sectors and also in our formal businesses. So we have most of them in clothing and services companies. So they are active in these two sectors, like more than other sectors.
Yeah, and food production as well in the informal business, informal sector.
Yes.
Yeah, which means processing a lot of food like jams, pickles, and drying vegetables, packaging, spices, and then selling them as they process them. All right, thank you.
Yeah.
Next, financial resources.
So we have the financial resources, the resources of finance which is available for businesswomen, and the sources that they are using for starting their businesses and for growth of their businesses. As it shows in the chart, they are using their own self money, and then they go and they reach to banks for their bank loans and for taking loan from their relatives. So it shows that in formal and informal businesses, they mostly rely on their own money, and then when they can't increase their source of the money and increase the growth of their businesses, so they go and they approach the bank and their relatives to taking some money. And most likely, some of the organizations, they provide them grants, and some of them, they are not providing grants. They use the fund of those organizations. But most likely, they are using their own self-money.
Okay, that's great. So this information was important because we think that many of these businesses that are established were established with basically grants. But it seems that grants went somewhere else, but these active businesses are the ones that have started with their own money.
Yes, we can see that the membership and business license, AWCCI has worked a lot in this sector because we have more informal businesses. And we have a campaign in AWCCI by the name of More Afghan Women in Businesses. We are working on making these informal businesses to convert their informal businesses to formal businesses. And as the chart shows that we have less number of business women who are active in formally based, and they are a member of AWCCI, and they are a member of some other unions or some other organizations, which they are taking the advantage and they are using the services of those organizations. So these business women have received the license from ACBAR and the municipalities, Ministry of Economies, and other organizations which are providing the license for their formal businesses. And other female which they are working in informal basis. So we are again working on them to motivate them to make their businesses formal and get use of other services which government and institutions and international organizations which are providing for them. So these women are in the type of their businesses. They are business owners in their individuals or limited liability or in the form of partnership.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so this was also very important for us, but also, I mean, as we work with other government and international entities, that these two licenses from municipality and Ministry of Commerce and Industry are the correct business licenses in Afghanistan. All others are unfortunately not really business licenses. So some, for example, with the Ministry of Public Health, they have received their license to practice health, but not making it as a profit business. They need to get another license from the Ministry of Commerce. Ministry of Justice is just for the associations. So yeah, some of our women, unfortunately, they are active with that license. Some are active with these other licenses, Ministry of Economy, which is totally a nonprofit license. So this is just for our information to really work with these women and educate them on what really business licenses are in Afghanistan and how a for-profit entity should function within all rules and regulations, especially, you know, starting with a license. So yeah, we hope that we could encourage them to change their licenses and as well as work with informal businesses to become formal businesses, because we need them to get connected with more opportunities, because when they're informal, unfortunately, a lot of opportunities won't go to them, only the ones that they have received already, and that's it. Okay, next is others, like education level, number of employees. Maybe just number of employees, Saida-jan.
Yes, Manizha-jan. As we can see that these businesswomen, they are proudly creating lots of opportunities for employees and for getting this opportunity created for the female and male. As you can see in the number that, again, they have created lots of job opportunities for male, and the less number is showing that it is for female. It's also related to their type of businesses, so they have to hire more male staff than female staff, but still it shows that they are creating good job opportunities in the market. And the rest you can see that it shows the number of businesswomen who are getting the benefit of having passport, or they having their national identity. The usage of website, which most of them are using the website and the social medias, and the level of their study and their it shows that most of them in the formal businesses, they have their bachelor degrees and masters and the secondary, and they are not illiterate, but in the level of business women who are informal, so we can see that they are uneducated, unfortunately. So this is the main cause that maybe they are in the informal businesses, and they are doing their businesses in the informal base. And the marital status, as you can see, that we have more number of single women in formal businesses, but in the informal businesses we had more married female businesses.
Okay, that's it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Saida-jan. As our audience saw, unfortunately, that would be one of the challenges to work with the informal businesses with the education level. So I'm hoping that a number of them are getting some of the literacy courses, or if you all could help them to connect them with literacy courses, because at least reading, writing is very important for them to be successful. We are sharing this presentation. Actually, we are sharing the whole set of data. This was not all the data that we have in our database, but just some very important ones that we shared today. It will be published on our website, www.awcci.af, under our publications, Business Women Statistics. So you all will see that hopefully in a week. As Saida-jan was saying, that we would like to improve the presentation of the charts, but today we were in a hurry to present it to you all. So thank you very much. Yes, we will share it. All right, Shahzad-jan. Shall we move to the next segment?
Yes, please. And yes, we're looking forward to the next segment, which is quite technical, but very interesting. And we're very pleased to welcome Thomas Tenboer, Country Director of WHH, and a interesting discussion on how to stimulate women's economic empowerment and women's employment. So again, over to you, Manizha-jan, as someone who's also initiated this discussion from your side, and also Thomas's expertise. So we're looking forward to hearing about this stimulating conversation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shahzad-jan. Thomas, can you please turn on your camera? Okay, that's great. Thank you. Thank you, Thomas. And are we're on time, right, Charles Johnson? That's great, right?
Yes, we are on time. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, thank you. All right, Thomas. So as Shazajan introduced Thomas, Thomas is the country director of WHH, and he previously has worked with the government of Netherlands in the tax department. So we are making good use of his expertise with how we can take some tax exemption, tax tax whatever, I mean, for women on businesses, especially and SMEs, of course, we would like for everyone to benefit, but as we are talking today for women businesses. So Thomas, we have approached our government several times. We have asked them to exempt, for example, women startups or women SMEs for the first maybe few years, or we've proposed different kinds of recommendations to them. But of course, every time we hear that it's not possible and the tax law is set, the tax law says all the citizens should be treated the same, so we don't have anything for men and women. How do you see this, Thomas?
Well, it's interesting to hear that the government can make changes. You know, even if the tax law is for everybody the same, you can have, let's say, you don't have to change the law. People have to realize that you can, let's say, make modifications if it is in procedures or legislation, where you can have a stimulus which you can allocate specifically for women, but you can do it for marginalized groups. You can even put it for specific sectors if you want to have to develop them much better. Yeah, so for me, if the government is saying we have to treat everybody equally, yes, but you don't have to change the law for it. So for me, it is where I'm looking at, if I hear also the conversations of all the women, it was interesting to see, for example, the number of employees, that the number of male was high and female was rather low. Governments worldwide, they have these kind of incentives where they are providing a stimulus for the private sector when they are recruiting women at certain positions, that they can have, let's say, a tax reduction from their taxable profitable income. So I am convinced that the government here has a difficulty to provide, let's say, financial means to businesses, for startup business or existing businesses. But if they give it in a tax incentive, it's, let's say, feeling less harmful. Yeah, they don't have to provide money. So I see a lot of potential what can be done. I compliment you with that you were able to get from industrial property that a part can be allocated for women. Well, if that is possible, then you can do it also with tax incentives. Yeah, so this property, it didn't cost them anything. They can allocate, they can make the gesture. They can do the same if it is with, let's say, tax reductions. If I see also how many women are, for example, in senior management positions within companies, it's quite limited. Only to stimulate that you have more women included in businesses, you can give, let's say, the private sector, you can give them the incentive if they are recruiting more women on these kind of positions, they can have a special tax exemption. So you are lowering the profit. The private sector is very eager to reduce the payment of tax. The private sector is so eager to keep people who are qualified and to keep them for a long time. So these kind of tax incentives can, let's say, stimulate that the private sector recruit more women on real senior positions, value positions, and they can keep them for a longer time, because then they will invest also in those people. Yeah, so this kind of incentive, it's used a lot worldwide. It was also interesting to see about women if they have their business. Sole businesses that were already 2000, partnership was around 460, I think, 450, and liability were only 50. If you see also that a majority of women, that they used their own money, well, if I combine this, it is for the government possible to make, let's say, an extra tax incentive that when people, when women start a business and they have it all registered, then they can have, let's say, an extra deductible cost. This will stimulate, because the women, I know, they have problems to go to the bank, yeah, and to get money in a loan. From family, it can be sometimes very difficult. If it is their own investment, you know, what is easier for the government than to stimulate it, to stimulate this sector? And you can start with small, but these kind of tax incentives are used also worldwide.
Yes, Thomas, thank you for sharing your insight. And I'm sure that's your, that has been your practical experience as well, with not changing actually the law, but changing some of the procedures and some of the regulations that are derived from those laws. And exactly this is what happened with the national procurement procedure. So when we proposed to the National Procurement Authority to give us some incentives in terms of either setting aside some contracts for women on annual basis, or the preferential clause that they have included right now, it's not in the law. So they didn't change the national procurement law. They just changed the national procurement procedure. And they include this clause in the national procurement procedure. So exactly, we can take some shortcuts to do that. And as you mentioned rightly, that with the number of informal businesses that we have, over 54,000, and maybe there are another 10 or 20,000 that we have not yet recognized and have not included them in the database. So with that, if you would like to encourage them to become formal businesses, we need some incentives for them, right? And especially that the size of the businesses they are. And with that, do you think the government will lose any revenue?
The government will win. You know, you have to see it from, if you only are changing or are amending, let's say, the procedures and regulations, it's still a do no harm, because men and women are still treated equally. So it's not that women get a higher salary if it is in an existing business. Men and women employed in the business has still the same salary. It is the owner of the business who can have a certain financial gain for it. So for me, it is very essential to have the principle there that nobody has to change the law, but that you can still play with the law in a way. You need to have a political commitment. The political parties have to say, yes, we go for it, but you can even give it a certain time frame. You can even help, let's say, the businesses over a period of time, yeah, for 4 years or 5 years. So they can, let's say, reduce the impact of it. However, they have to realize as government, the more economical progress is made here in the country, it will return later in much more, let's say, investment of the private sector in the country, and that will help the government much more. Because the government, if they want to create employment, they need the private sector. They need initiatives, as I heard now this evening. Those are great initiatives. And that is where the government gain much more.
Yes, let's hope that the government, and we could work with the government officials. We actually, due to the COVID-19's impact, we had conducted a survey, and after a survey, we developed a strategy. And with that strategy, we actually approached recently the government to discuss some tax incentives and tax not really much of exempting, but really giving them a long-term installment basis for this year to the next years. So they paid, because of course everyone lacks cash at this moment. There they showed some flexibility and they said, yeah, if it's not tax exemption, they can go with these other approaches such as this one to go with long-term installments. And we hope that they work with us to really get this done. All right, so let's see if there is anything else that you would like to share, Thomas, on this issue or any other issue that we discussed so far on women businesses in Afghanistan. And we have a question from the audience on whether we can get the Minister of Finance. Yeah, Fiona, we have started working with the Minister of Finance and they have showed support, not with tax exemption, but some incentives and making long-term installments and so on, especially for this year, 2020. So let's hope, but we still hope to put together a plan for the informal businesses to create an incentive for them, because it would be very difficult for them to get a license and immediately start complying with the tax obligations and so on. Thomas.
Well, you know, for me, the only message to the government is the Afghan women are 50% of the population, and you cannot exclude 50% of the population. Yeah.
Yes.
It is a society, and society is men and women. And they must stimulate women as much as men, that they start, you know, to be productive and what they can do for their own country. We don't have to teach the people that much. The people know a lot. They only need to have the opportunity. That's my message.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Thomas. That's a great message. We need to provide them with the opportunities so they make their lives better and everyone else's in the communities. Thank you. All right, Shahzadjan, over to you.
Thank you so much, Manizha John and Thomas. Thanks very much for that very interesting discussion. Hope it will generate more conversation around this important topic. Are there any questions that were left unanswered, Manizha John? We have a few participants who provided their emails, and we'll definitely add you to our contact list, and we'll be in touch. A few participants have asked to be connected to our panel members, and with their permission, we'll definitely do that. And if there's no other question pending, or if there are any questions that are left unanswered, we will definitely be communicating with everyone. And of course, please do get in touch with us at ACBAR and also AWCCI. I can leave our contact details in the chat box. But if there's no other questions or points remaining, it just leaves me to thank our amazing panel members. We were really excited to have the opportunity for everyone to hear their voices, especially in the run-up to the upcoming conference of Afghanistan. Normally, when you hear about Afghanistan, usually it's a one-sided aspect that you hear about, but we wanted to bring the amazing talent and creativity and basically the drive that our amazing panel members have. Obviously, there are many such amazing women in Afghanistan, and we hope we were able to share some of their stories and to bring their voices directly to you. Thank you so much to our amazing moderator, Manizha John, you've done an amazing job, and I hope you will be able to take some rest after this intense but really interesting event, and also to your colleague Saida John and to Thomas. And I will hand over to Lisa John to give us a quick goodbye in closing of the meeting. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sharza John. Thank you for the great partnership, ACBAR. Thank you.
So Lisa, over to you. I think we may have lost Lisa's connection. So I will thank her as well. Thank everyone on behalf of Lisa as well. And hope to stay in touch, and let's do keep the communication line open and share similar amazing stories and news and knowledge sharing. So thank you very much. Have a lovely day ahead of you and a lovely evening for those in Afghanistan and in between in Europe and other countries. And keep an eye out for news about the conference on Afghanistan, and let's keep Afghanistan high on the agenda. Yes, there's a lot of prospect and potential, and let's not forget Afghanistan. Thank you to everyone, and see you soon. Bye bye.
Goodbye.
Fez. شهرزاد جان میشنوین؟ بله؟
بله بله میشنوم.
سلام، خسته نباشین. بسیار معذرت میخوام به خاطر یک کم گلیچ اینترنت.
نه.
We could cover most of
Yes, no, it was fine. Thank you.
Well, congratulations on such a wonderful feedback that you're getting. So, really really congratulations, and my apologies for small glitch, and I hope that we could cover this to maximum in the future. And I wish you very, very good health, Sharzad Jan.
Thank you so much, Dr. Farhad. And yes, it was it was very useful. And the interpretation helped us to make it as inclusive as possible. So thank you so much for your help. And
thank you.
It happened everywhere.
For your great work.
Thank you, and I'll speak to you soon.
Sure. Thank you so much for your understanding. Okay, I leave the meeting with your permission. Seems like you got mute and you need to take rest. Stay safe.
You too. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.